And welcome to the Queen Anne's County Board of Education, December 14th meeting. At this time, we'd like to turn the meeting over to the Queen Anne's County Clerk of Courts, Mr. Scott McGlashan, to lead our newly elected and re-elected members in their oath of office.
Thank you, Mrs. George. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. I'm Scott McGlashan, Clerk of the Circuit Court of Queen Anne's County, and we have the honor this evening of swearing in two new board members. And first, Greg said he would read the governor's commissions to each individual.
It is my honor to read the governor's citation from the state of Maryland to Beverly G. Kelly of Queen Anne's County. Be it known that the people of Queen Anne's County, reposing great trust and confidence in your integrity, wisdom, and wisdom, did on the 8th day of November 2016, elected you to the Board of Education for District 3. You are, therefore, to execute the said office justly, honestly, diligently, and faithfully according to the law, and hold the same for a term of 4 years beginning on December 5th, 2016, or until you shall be discharged therefore, given under my hand the great seal of Maryland, our governor, Larence Hogan, Jr. It is my honor for the second citation on the governor of the state of Maryland to Sharyn G. Harlow of Queen Anne's County. Be it known that the people of Queen Anne's County, reposing great trust and confidence in your integrity and wisdom, did on the 8th day of November 2016 elect you to the Board of Education for District 4. You are therefore to execute the said office justly, honestly, diligently, and faithfully according to the law, and hold the same for a term of 4 years beginning on December 5th, 2016, or until you shall be Duluth of therefore or therefrom, given under my hand and the great seal of Maryland by our governor, Larence Hogan, Jr.
You to come forward and I will administer your oath of office.
I think you're going to have those framed or something.
Yeah. Yeah, I'll give them to Pop.
There we go. Okay, you better save it. I can't get here so you two can.
You better not give me anything you got.
Yeah. If you raise your right hands and repeat after me. I, insert your name.
I, Sharyn Harlow.
Do swear or affirm.
Do swear or affirm.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
That I will support the Constitution of the United States.
And I will be faithful.
And I will be faithful.
And bear true allegiance to the state of Maryland.
And bear true allegiance to the state of Maryland.
And support the Constitution.
And support the Constitution.
And laws thereof.
And laws thereof.
And that I will.
And that I will.
To the best of my skill and judgment.
The best of my skill and judgment.
Diligently and faithfully.
Diligently and faithfully.
Without partiality or prejudice.
Without partiality or prejudice.
Execute the office of.
Execute the office of.
Member of the Queen Anne's County Board of Education.
Member of the Queen Anne's County Board of Education.
According to the Constitution.
According to the Constitution.
And laws of this state.
And laws of this state.
Congratulations, ladies.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, they will now sign the test book, which in Queen Anne's County go back to approximately 1870. So your grandchildren, great-great-grandchildren, great-great-great-grandchildren will be able to see this document. On behalf of the citizens of Queen Anne's County and the clerk of your court, we thank you. And thank you, the elected Board of Education of Queen Anne's County. It's a tough job, but our education is terribly, terribly important. Greg, thank you.
Thank you, sir.
Ladies and gentlemen, have a round of applause, please.
Welcome, Sharyn, and welcome back, Beverly. At this time, I need a motion to go into closed session.
So move.
I have a motion. Do I have a second? Oh, I'm sorry. She needs, mm-hmm. you need to read your.
As permitted by the section 3-305B, the general provision article of the Annotated Code of Maryland, I move that we go into closed session to discuss it, the appointment, employment, assignment, promotion, the discipline, demotion, compensation, removal, resignation, or performance evaluations of appointees, employees, or officials over whom this public body has jurisdiction, or any other personal matter that affects one or more specific individual to view transportation's report and meeting minutes for the month of November, to conduct collective bargaining negotiations or consider matters that relate to the negotiations, and to discuss the potential legal concerns.
I have a motion. Do I have a second?
So moved.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to go into closed session. All in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Thank you, and we will return at 6 p.m.
Good evening, and welcome to the Board of Education meeting for Queen Anne's County. This is a public meeting that is being videotaped for county citizens to review on QACTV7, a local cable station. The agenda is available on the information table found to the right when you come in. During this meeting, we ask that you turn off your cell phones and or pagers, hold personal conversations and comments outside the meeting room. We will now stand and be led in the Pledge of Allegiance, I believe by our board president.
Correct.
I pledge allegiance
to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
According to legislation regarding our elected Board of Education members, at our first meeting in December, we must hold elections of officers. Instead of taking nominations from the floor, we will be electing by closed ballot. In this process, each member was given a ballot to indicate a candidate for the office of Board President and Board Vice President. Board members, I will now entertain a motion to proceed with the election of office of Board President and Board Vice President.
So moved.
Second. Do we second?
So you have a motion and a second.
Motion and a second. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it. Board members, please cast your ballot. Allow you about 3 to 5 minutes to make your selection, and then please pass your ballot to Ms. Wright, who will tally once you have completed. Ms. Wright has gathered the ballots. She will tally those and return them to me with the results. And she will verify that information, and then I will announce the next board president and vice president.
Thank you.
by way of closed ballot, Board Member Arlene Taylor will serve as our next board president, and Board Member Mrs. Annette DiMaggio will serve as our Board of Education Vice President for 2017. At this time, I will now turn the meeting over to Board Member Reverend Taylor, your new board president of the Queen Anne's County Board of Education.
I would like to thank everyone. And we'll move forward. I appreciate your votes, and I will try my very best to serve the people of Queen Anne's County with all humility. May I have a motion to approve the agenda? A motion to approve the minutes for November.
So moved.
Can I have a second?
I have a second.
Alrighty. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
Ayes have it. We will now turn this over to Mr. Paluski for the students' recognition.
Okay. Let me grab my...
She did it in one motion.
Okay. At this time, I would ask the board to join me down front.
Do we have to? Can we wait until January?
Okay,
yeah. Are you okay with that?
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Ladies and gentlemen, good evening. Tonight, we'd like to express our appreciation and thanks for the effort of our talented staff and students. The Hero Award. The Queen Anne's County Public Schools Hero Award is sponsored by our friends at Six Flags Theme Park, including Debbie Evans, who offers two complimentary tickets to Six Flags, along with the Anti-Bullying Committee and Character Counts, which are great partners of our school system and organization. This month's Hero Award will be given to Kamira Lee, who is a kindergartner at Ken Island Elementary School. Ms. Kamira, would you please come forward? She is the world's best sister, I can tell. She told me that. Great. Stand right here. Great. Miss Flowers, Kamira's substitute teacher, nominated her for this award because of her continuous kind acts in school. Miss Flower explains how Kamira constantly helps another student in her class who is in a wheelchair without even being asked. Her initiative to help others, students, continuously every day is such a joy to watch. Kamira's kindness, her big heart, and willingness to help make her a great example of her classmates to follow. Ms. Kamira, thank you so much for being a hero at Ken Island Elementary School. With you. Your world's best sister.
Can you back up now?
Okay.
Back up a little bit.
Ready?
Let's go
move over here.
Here you go. One, two, three. Thank you.
Mom, do you want to get closer to get a picture? Come on.
And the teacher's here as well. The teacher is here.
Oh, and the teacher's
here.
Ms. Flowers, I want your help, please.
That's our teacher, Ms. Amos.
Oh, Ms. Amos. Let's get you here for a picture. Geneva, can you take?
Yeah.
Here, come on.
Are you her teacher?
Yes.
All right, 1, 2, 3. All right, off.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
Also this evening, we have a special recognition. Would Miss April Quigley please come forward? Miss April Quigley is a PE teacher at Churchill Elementary School, was the award recipient of the Simon McNeely Award honored by the Maryland Association of Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance. And a former teacher of the year. What's in the water up there? Ms. Quigley was recognized as the Maryland Association of Health, Physical Education, Recreation, and Dance Banquet, as well as the Maryland General Assembly. She was recognized for her dedication to her profession and for her promotion of a healthier, more creative, and active Maryland citizens. She demonstrates outstanding teaching, innovative through teaching and service practices and workshops, conferences, and is active involving health fairs in the community. Thank you, Ms. Quigley, for your dedication and commitment to enhancing the health of students at Churchill Elementary School and being a model employee for Queen Anne's County Public Schools. Thank you.
Thank you.
Our last special recognition this evening, we would like to take this chance to recognize the Anti-Bullying Unity Day Committee. In October, over the last several years, is our annual Queen Anne's County Public Schools Unity Day event. And it's all thanks to our amazing sponsors and our anti-bullying committee. We are thankful for the staff and community members who are dedicated to addressing bullying issues in Queen Anne's County and helping find a solution. Unity Day has been one of our biggest events ever. One of our community events through months of hard work. Unity Day was once again a huge success. And if those members are here that represent that committee, Ms. Tracy Donahoe, Linda Austin, Jackie Carter, Leslie Fulham, Sterling Ward, Mary Condon, Elaine Butler, and Crystal Foster, if they would please come forward. On their behalf, I would like to thank these ladies for their help in making this day and this event become an event for all Queen Anne's County and could feel that they belong and they are heard and they are together as one. Queen Anne's County Public Schools is grateful to have staff and community members like these individuals who would help to ensure that Queen Anne's County Public Schools is a happier, a fair, kind, and bully-free learning environment. We thank them for all of their hard work, and we would look forward to another successful Unity Day next year. Please join me in a round of applause, even though those individuals are here.
Okay.
At this time, we'll have citizen participation and public comments. VP.
We ask all speakers to keep in mind the following guidelines. Speakers should sign the roster, including their telephone number and address. Comments should be limited to 2 minutes in length. Comments longer than 2 minutes should be submitted in writing. Questions or statements to the board should relate to recent agenda item, an agenda item that is expected to appear in the future, or a matter of general policy over which the board has authority. Please do not discuss items related to negotiations. Those items are to be discussed at the bargaining table. Citizen participation is not intended to be a question and answer session. If you have specific questions, the board will make sure an appropriate staff member responds to your questions at a later date. The board respects your desire and right to convey your message freely, but ask as a courtesy to this board and our citizens that you respect the board's request to refrain from naming citizens and name-calling when offering your critique. We have one person on the agenda, which would be Mr. Richard McNeil.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Good evening.
Richard McNeil, and I'm representing myself and the retired educators group, so just a few comments. First off, I'd like to congratulate Captain Kelly for her reelection and reappointment to the board, and I know that the hard work that you've done in the past, and look forward to what's coming up in the future for the kids and the teachers of the school system. And I'd like to verbally say thanks to Tammy Harper for her service. She's not here, but I want to make sure that I recognize that, and it's because she's put in there. And welcome to Ms. Harlow for the next 4 years, I assume, and looking forward to your opinions and your direction and your questions in terms of where we're headed in our system. Later on this evening, I see in the agenda the mentor program that Kathy Draper is going to update. I was here for myself just to comment on that. I know that as budgets get underway and things are looked at, sometimes small programs, in a sense, are looked at. Maybe we can rearrange those and reduce those. And I don't want to say that the mentor program is a small program at all, because in my 3 years of working with that, I think it has been a huge success. And beyond that, it's been a success. I have enjoyed myself working with the first and second year teachers that I have, and it has, I think, paid off for our system. We have a dedicated group of retirees who are out there working with these folks every single day, pretty much, and just like to make sure that that continues, because I just think it's great to see these teachers grow in the profession, and if they're not growing in the profession, to coach them to find another job, because teaching is hard. It's our children in the county, and we want to make sure they're getting the best that they can, instruction-wise. So just to say that, I want to thank you for your continued support of the healthcare program for the retirees. We had our December luncheon meeting yesterday, and we were recognized by the state president and the executive director. They joined us, and we're very pleased with what we're doing. We have a very active member right now of 159, and we have more retirees that we're trying to get on board, but for some reason they go to Florida and don't want to come to our luncheons, and I don't understand that, but thank you for your continued support on that. And lastly, I'd like to, having worked in the school system for 40-some years, I know that we have a good program, but, you know, this past fall, we had close to 8 teams, I think, if I counted up right, between both high schools who made it to the state playoffs and the regional playoffs, and some made it into the final four, and some made it right to the final two. And just like to congratulate the athletes, the coaches, the parents who support that, because you know, we have two very good high schools. We have very good feeder schools, And most of our athletes are also honor athletes. They're on the honor rolls, and most of them are 4.0 students or better. So we appreciate that. And if you haven't been to any of the school winter programs, I've been to two. They've been wonderful. I know it's a busy time this week and next week. If you have an opportunity, please go out. I told the retirees yesterday, we gave them the dates and when things were going on, and encouraged them to be a part of that program. It's not too often you can go to someplace free and get really good entertainment for the holiday season. So thank you. Best wishes. Happy New Year.
Thank you, Mr. January. Thank you. Okay.
Happy holidays.
I might see you tomorrow.
I look forward to it.
At this time, we'll have the student members of the board reports and presentations. I don't know who was last.
Just pick one.
Go ahead.
Meeny, meeny, miny, mo.
I'll go first. Mm-hmm. All right, so this summer we don't have too much going on, but our winter sports has begun. And we're doing okay so far. Our basketball team, our girls are 3-0, and our guys are 0-1, but that's okay. We'll get there. Our hockey team actually has a game tonight, and what I think is cool, against Kent Island, but I think our team is losing, so it's okay. But but they get to play at the Naval Stadium.
Oh, fun.
So I think that's really cool that they get to go there. Our Christmas break is December 31st through January 1st. And then next week we have our Holiday Spirit Week, and that'll be fun. We get to wear pajamas and ugly sweaters, so I'm looking forward to it. And then for our musical, our theater department has unveiled the spring musical, and it's going to be The Sound of Music. So we're excited about that. And our performance day is March 3rd. I'll put that on the calendar.
Okay, that sounds good.
Hey guys, I hope everyone's having a great day. same with Paige, we also don't have that much going on during the month of December. But for student government updates, we have Sweater Day next Thursday on December 22nd, which is where kids will be able to wear their favorite holiday sweaters, the ugly holiday sweaters. And they'll have the ability to be entering themselves into a drawing, and then they can win a $25 Dunkin' Donuts gift card. And we all love coffee, so I'm excited for that. Also, we get to walk down a runway. And like 2 years ago, I walked down with the buck, like the person in the costume. To this day, I have no idea who it was, but it was so much fun. And then on November 30th, we had our winter choral concert. It went amazing. And then December 12th, we had our winter dance concert. I went, everything was cool. I can't dance though, but. And then our chorus our school's chorus is going to Disney World, which is so cool, from this Thursday to Sunday, which is so cool because I want to go to Disney World. On December 16th, the PTSA is hosting a cookie extravaganza for teachers, which is where a wide variety of cookies are donated and placed in the teacher's lounge for them to enjoy. December 20th is their winter band concert. If anybody's not doing anything, you can come check that out. Our winter sports are also off to a great start. I don't have any stats for you guys, though. But our swim team has been offered a new facility at Club One. And Mr. Shrek says, quote unquote, it is beyond gorgeous. And we are completely appreciative of that. And after winter break, the teachers and students are going to be gearing up for our final exams. That's all I have for you today.
Thank you very much, ladies. Next, we'll hear from our food services, Sadeco, on an overview of services.
Ms. Schultz is joined by our partnership for Sodexo, which is going to give us a little bit of an overview.
All right.
Good evening. I'm Tony Schultz. I'm the coordinator of supporting services, and we've partnered with Sodexo since 1992, and they basically manage our food service, take care of making sure we meet all the state requirements and staffing. I'm basically the liaison between Sodexo and the board, and the board and the state. So they're going to give us an overview of where we are and what we're doing right now.
There you go.
This is George Higley, he's the district manager.
Good evening, everybody.
We have Vicki Mueller, who's the area manager, and Bruce Corgray, who's their general manager.
Thank you, sir.
I can hit the thing.
Yeah, you can do it quicker. All right, well, good evening, everybody, and happy holidays to y'all.
Thank you.
Really appreciate the opportunity to be up here giving you an overview. Congratulations to the re-elected board and for the new board members. Congratulations. It's a great partnership. I've been affiliated personally here since 1992. I was a second GM through Queen Anne, so y'all got me in good shape and got me promoted to a regional job, so I appreciate that. Definitely have a big heart for Queen Anne's because this is where I started on the school side with Sodexo, originally with Marriott. We've been in here since 92. We operate with 65 great hourly employees. Those are the folks right in the front line. A great crew. Over the years, we've been able to promote from within, which I always advocate. And it's great. We have moms, parents that are in the communities, the children are in the schools, and they kind of get to move along and progress with the students. So really what we do up here, I mean, we do a lot, but really, I mean, we're Sodexo, but since the beginnings, even when I was here, we try to blend. We're part of the cloth of Queen Anne's. We're not this Sodexo here and Queen Anne's here. We just try to blend in and pursue the goals and the excellence that Queen Anne's definitely known in the state for. I mean, you guys are the leaders. You were the leader. You're still the leaders in food service. You were the first outsourced contracted food service company contract in the state of Maryland. Been there for 24 years. Talbot County came on board last year. There's a couple more districts now that we're talking to in Maryland. So, I mean, the great work that's been done here by the hourly folks and through our partnership has enabled that. So I appreciate that. Sodexo provides meals. I mean, our basic charge is to provide meals to the students with a variety to meet the ever-changing, and I underline that word, ever-changing USDA and the state guidelines. So, you know, as an example, if you look 5 years back, the students could come through and pretty much, I mean, within reason, they could get that white bread sub, and then that all changed, really, 6 years ago. So initially, you know, What we're really seeing now is the students that were the elementary kids that are all coming through that cycle now. They've kind of learned the new requirements, and so we're seeing that cycle through. MSD, we're a strong partner with. Bruce Forgrave has worked during the summers with MSDA. They have a boot camp for food service workers. This man right here is a great culinarian. I think you tasted a little bit tonight before we came down. But he's going to be a great innovator up here for Queen Anne's. And really, the charge with bringing Bruce in as your new general manager was on the culinary side. We've always had great food, great service. Now we're looking for that, the extra pizzazz, the display cooking, the summer barbecues for all the PTA functions that we do during the summer, their field days. So really, that's going to be Bruce's charge. And that's mainly part of the our purpose. Our objective here, of course, is 100% compliance with the federal and state audits. So we successfully passed the MSDA state audit, just finished that up. We have a final exit interview next week, but we don't expect any high recommendations. We expect a high pass. And that's what we've come to know up here in Queen Anne's County. Basically, what they do is they do due diligence. They go back and they audit all the records we have, all the menus, everything is in compliance. It's a whole, as you can imagine, you all have your statutes through the state that you have to manage. We have to do the same thing. So in essence, we're managing the food side for you folks. Probably the biggest thing is for us that we've always had, and it was nice to see Mr. McNeil because he was a principal back when I was a GM, but we've always had that open line of communications in the buildings with the principals, with the teachers, the staff, and we're really pushing the envelope as far as trying to engage the students. We've always had some one-on-ones, but now we're looking at first of the year really going to feedback. And it's different, you know, back in the day it used to be a piece of paper, but technology seems to be the call of the day for the high school folks now. So that's where we're trying to get to. We're trying to get to a survey tool that's going to give us some feedback. We're not looking for, you know, Sodexo is great. We're looking for the next step that we can innovate with the students. I can remember back when we opened Kent Island High School as an example. They used to get pizza here on the island, if you can believe, from Domino's. And we got the breadsticks and all that. And I'm like, well, how can we do that and innovate? So the innovation, one young man said, he said, well, basically from Domino's, it's just a bag, Mr. Higley. You guys get the bag and you put the sauce, you're probably going to sell just as many. So we got the same bag, didn't say Domino's on it. We got the sauce, and he was exactly right. So innovation to us, you know, the folks sitting here, is it's not Sodexo in a bottle, the magic, it's the students. So we're really going to, you know, hang our hat on that January going through the end of the year. Queen Anne's County High School, we're looking to innovate, actually renovate a little bit over there. We have the new middle line, but they have the service lines from probably when the school opened. So in January, on the line that's on the left side, that's going to be finally taken out. We're going to put a brand new line in there, and then the spring we'll come back and get the one on the right side. So virtually, you'll have some new service lines. Our partnership extends beyond just the borders of our vendors. We try to work with, we're really trying to forge in with the local farmers. Godfrey's is right next to Suttlersville Middle School. Luckily, last year I got a tour from the Godfrey's and I learned all about asparagus. So the little asparagus is the new plants, the thick stuff is the older plants. And really it makes sense for us, we're operating in the community, to really see where we can forge and use the local partners. So Godfrey's, of course, it's seasonal. You know, there's really nothing going on at Godfrey's right now. But where we can, they're partnered with one of our main vendors, which is Keeney. Keeney actually runs a truck to Godfrey's and does a backhaul, or picks up the goods and brings them across the bridge. So we started two springs ago, you know, just with strawberries. Now they have peaches up there. And we're really trying to see what we can bring in through Godfrey's. There's also Taylor's Farm up a little further. We haven't done anything with them yet, but we're really looking to forge the local vendors. And for us to do that, we can bring them through Keeney, who's our produce partner, that cuts down the insurance and that whole piece of the puzzle for us. So we'll continue to forge with that. As far as what we're doing right now, I mean, we are doing a lot. Maryland Meals for Achievement. Basically, in the Suttlersville schools, we have the high, free, and reduced. We're doing breakfast in the classroom, which is, you know, served right in the classroom. We're doing all the lunches and all the components where we can. We're involved in snacks. Certainly, we do a big business as far as, not business, but we cater a lot of meals. We do the athletic banquets, do the coaches' picnics. So wherever we can engage that, we try to engage that. We also understand that, you know, sometimes community folks like to do their thing, so... You know, if they want to do it, we let them do it. We provide a variety of menu options, and that's ever-changing, like I said. Fun on the Run is a little bag with a little, you know, kind of, I don't want to say gimmicky bag, but it's got the little colorful pieces on it. The kids really like that. And really, we get a higher participation when we put it in the bag. No matter what we put in the bag, they come and get it, so.
Like a Happy Meal.
Yeah, like that. Well, better than a Happy Meal, nutritious.
Like a Lunchable.
Yeah, Lunchable. Mm-hmm. The hourly staff, like I said, Sodexo, we oversee the hourly staff, 65 folks. And basically what we've tried to do with our hourly folks here is just, you know, they are one big family. I mean, some of those folks, Miss Ann, who's at the high school, she's been here since probably longer than us. And it's just taking care of the hourly employees. I mean, they're a group, they're a team. They're in the community.
Big holiday party tomorrow.
Big holiday party tomorrow. Stop by. And really just try to engage them, promote them where we can. And a lot of folks have retired with us. They've worked all the way through. And, you know, it's a great pleasure for us. It's an honor to have them working for us. As far as some of the things we have going on throughout the year, we have the Healthy High School Challenge, and that's all about, it's a nationwide challenge, which really, it's trying to get healthy snacks into the high schools and get the students to participate. So I don't know if you folks saw that, participated in it. Hope you did.
A little bit.
Future Chefs, we've been the leader. I mean, when it came out 8 years ago, Queen Anne's was really the first school district to put that out there, and basically it's taken elementary schools or middle school kids, it rotates every other year, and it gives them, they create their own recipes, and then they come and they put it together, and then they're ranked, and there's a school district winner, it goes up to a regional winner, all the way to the national winner. And the national winners, they usually pick 12, and they make a calendar out of that. So it's pretty cool. Student meetings, like we said, really getting ongoing discussions with the students and seeing their likes and dislikes, of course. We could serve steak and lobster tails, we'd do it, but we can't. So we do our best there. The feedback surveys, like I said, we'll start that in January. The DOD produce, that's the government produce arm, and basically what that allows us to do, it allows us through our commodities to use the commodity dollars in these months when we're coming into November, December, January, where there's, you know, high-priced produce, we get the same price as the government does. So that's a pretty good deal. As far as achievements and future planning, the MSDA state audit, it was very successful. Echo Shore, which is it's an unannounced safety audit. They come on site with Sodexo charge to come on site. The minimal passing score is 98.6. If it's not a 98.6, that's not a good place to be, but you guys have been in the gold for 7 years running. No pressure, Bruce.
SP College has been in the gold, too.
Right. So Bruce Forgrave, above Bruce Forgrave, I mean, he's been at Chesapeake College, of course, with us. He's a good example of promoting from within. He came up as an hourly, worked his way up, became a chef, 18 years over there at Chesapeake College, phenomenal culinarian, and he really is a down-to-earth guy, works with the people, good friend, but just a phenomenal leader that I think is going to be he'll take good to great, or great to even greater at Queen Anne's. And like I said, the new hotline at Queen Anne's County High School, that's forthcoming. So really, I guess the big conclusion for me here is just, you know, we're going to continue to innovate for you folks, continue to partner at the direction, we serve at the direction and pleasure of the board and the citizens of Queen Anne's and the students. So we're just trying to gather that input and keep the program moving forward. And sincerely, really appreciate the partnership. It's meant a lot, just professionally and then, you know, community. I mean, I know kids at both high schools. I coach swimming, so I know both high schools. You got phenomenal kids up here, so really appreciate it. I don't know if anybody has any questions or.
No, sounds good.
Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
No questions.
Okay. Thank you.
All right. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Happy holidays.
Happy holidays. Next, at this time, we'll hear from the teacher's mentor program.
Yeah, we have Mrs. Straper, who actually leads our mentor teacher program, is going to prepare to do a quick overview of our mentor teacher program. Mm-hmm.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen.
Good evening. Good evening.
It's a pleasure to be here tonight to talk about a subject that is near and dear to my heart, and that is the Teacher Mentor Program, because I've been privileged to work with it since its inception, which occurred in late 1999 into 2000. So, yeah, that'd be great. Okay. Thanks, Janet.
You're welcome.
And so because it is so near and dear to my heart, I feel like it's almost a child to me. So, but one of the reasons that it is so important, or the reason it is so important, is that we want to provide the best support to our new teachers. And when I say new teachers, I really mean our novice teachers through the mentor program. So if you come in as a teacher with 5 or 8 years of experience from some other system, you will not be assigned a teacher mentor. But if you are new, and we define new as somebody with 3 or fewer years of experience, we will assign you a mentor to to work with you for the first 2 years of your employment in most cases. So why do we have mentors? Well, we have them so that a novice teacher can experience that non-evaluative support. Mm-hmm. You know, we all have people who evaluate us no matter what our job is, and that's the job of people like principals and supervisors and things like that. Sometimes there's that need for a novice teacher to have someone who is more like a confidant or a critical friend, and that's a critical piece, that because it's that relationship of trust that's created between the mentor and the novice teacher, or the mentee. I'll use those terms interchangeably, that critical friend piece. And why do we want to do that? Well, we want to increase the rate of success in our novice teachers' classrooms, because we feel an obligation as a school system and ethically as individuals that students deserve the very best. And so one of the ways we try to bridge the gap, so to speak, between a teacher who has many years of experience and one who is brand new is to provide that extra support to them, so that support to the teacher translates into support for the students, which we hope will end up being increased achievement on the part of those students. And the other thing we want to do is we want to promote teacher retention. Mm-hmm. That's one of the goals of our system, to have not to, to hire the very best that we can and keep them. And we see this as another piece of keeping those very effective teachers. And as I believe me, I didn't pay Richard to come in earlier and give a little speech of support, but I certainly appreciated his words a little bit earlier. Mm-hmm. So what are our objectives? Well, to go along with that, we want to enhance those schools, the skills and knowledge of our novice teachers. And because we're enhancing their skills, we hope that they have increased job satisfaction and that that will translate into continued service to our students. And what are some of the things that we work on with our novice teachers? Well, we work on effective teaching models. Maybe classroom management is an issue for the novice teacher. So the mentors help novice teachers in honing their skills with classroom management. One of the things that sometimes is frightening for new teachers is that first communication they have with parents. And so we try to help them realize that we're all a partnership, that parents and teachers are in partnership with students in achieving success for students. And so we try to give them some practical advice along those lines. Obviously, helping them to understand what our school policies and procedures are, what the culture of Queen Anne's County is, what does it mean to be a teacher in Queen Anne's County, and how does one succeed there. And then also a huge piece is that monitoring of student success. Not that the mentor does it as an individual, but assists the teacher in ways of monitoring student success, in ways of improving student success through particular strategies and things like that. What do you have to do to be a mentor? Well, first of all, it's a part-time hourly position, so you have to be the type of person who can work in that situation. All of our mentors are experienced teachers. If I had to hazard a guess, because I didn't do this mathematics, I would say we have 16 mentors. They're all retired people. So we would suppose they had a minimum of 30 years. 16 times 30 is 480, but many of them have more years than that. So 480 years of experience is quite a bit of experience in our little group. They meet the state criteria in terms of certification and things like that. The most important thing, though, is that commitment they have to the profession. They don't do the job because they make a lot of money. because they haven't had a raise since we started the program in 1999. So you don't do this job because you want to get rich. They do it because they have a commitment to the profession of teaching and a commitment to the students in Queen Anne's County. That's where it comes from, and that's where they derive their greatest success. There's nothing like seeing the students in a classroom of a teacher that they're mentoring, seeing that success. There's nothing like seeing the growth of the novice teacher for the mentors. So they have to do that. They also commit to attending monthly meetings, and we have professional development for them, 3 hours every month. And I'll talk a little bit about that in a bit. And then, of course, they have to have a valid driver's license because they have to be able to get themselves to school. So many of our mentors work in more than one school. So what kinds of things do we provide professional development on? We always spend a portion every year of talking about what it is to be a good mentor. What are the qualities and characteristics that a good mentor displays? What are the attributes? We also revisit the topic every year of the characteristics of adult learners, because all of our mentors have been teachers, but teachers of students, children, pre-K to grade 12. The strategies that you use when you're working with adults differ a little bit, and so we provide professional development in that area. This year, a big subject for us is a revisit of collaborative coaching, or similar to peer coaching, but that notion of what is the best strategy to use when interacting with a particular novice teacher. We've dealt with that topic before, but we've had a little bit of turnover in our mentor group, and so it's never a bad idea to revisit some subjects, especially one as important as the coaching that they do. We're always very cognizant of working with the Maryland College and Career Ready standards. Those are the standards that our students have to achieve. They're the standards that our teachers have to include in their instruction, and so our mentors, we strive to keep them up to date on all of those things. We see up there county and school-wide professional development. What we mean there is we try to keep abreast of the professional development that teachers are receiving either at the county level or the school-wide level, so that everybody's singing the same song, so to speak, that the mentors are in tune with and knowledgeable of what the initiatives are in the county and also in the individual schools where they work, so that there's a connection for the novice teachers, so it doesn't seem disconnected for them. And so every year we invite folks like the assistant superintendent, the superintendent, central office staff in curriculum and instruction to present to the mentors on whatever their particular programs and initiatives are for the year, so that there's that understanding and knowledge. There's nothing like communication. Yes. It's critical. Okay. Now, we have here this year, this information is this year's information. We have 16 mentors serving 50 novice teachers. Of those novice teachers, 24 of them are first-year teachers, and 26 are second-year teachers. The way the regulation reads in Comar, we are obliged to serve all first- and second-year novice teachers. We continue to serve for the third year those novice teachers whom the building principals recommend. For one reason or another, they may think that a teacher needs an additional year, and we provide that. We schedule for that. So at this time, we don't have anyone being served for the third year. Some years we do, some years we don't. It's never a huge number. but this year we don't. So we have six of the mentors are serving 18 elementary novice teachers at seven schools. One school has no novice teachers, so we have no one working there, and that's Churchill. We have 12 mentors serving 29 secondary novice teachers, and I'm including middle school and high school there. For the highest number of novice teachers in the county is at Queen Anne's High School. There are 15 that we're serving right now. We have two mentors serving three teachers at Anchor Points. And so, as I said a little bit earlier, we have mentors who serve at multiple schools and sometimes multiple levels. Sometimes, you know, I have a mentor or two who's equally comfortable at elementary, say, and middle school. And so that makes it very nice, that that kind of openness or freedom to assign. And another point I'd like to make is that where possible, we assign mentors by content, especially at the secondary level, if we can. You know, for instance, if you're a novice teacher in mathematics, we try to assign a mentor whose background was mathematics when teaching, and we do that as much as we can. It's not always pure. You know, we might have a welding teacher who needs a mentor, and I don't have any mentors whose background was welding, so we'd have to use a more generalist approach. And what do we pay for these services? Well, I mentioned earlier they haven't had a raise. So the numbers that you see here are based on 50 mentors, because that's how we, mentees rather, that's how we budget. We budget 2 hours per week of direct services per mentee at $25 an hour. So that's the bulk of the budget, the weekly interaction of the mentor and mentee. Then we also budget for visitations, two per year per mentee, to go to another teacher's classroom escorted by the mentor, so that when if they're going to maybe get some pointers on asking higher order questions, that could be an objective for a visit. The mentor goes with the mentee, and then they have that time later to debrief. Typically, they will use a full day and visit maybe several teachers to get to the point they want to get to. And then finally, the other cost is the monthly professional development, and which I mentioned earlier, 3 hours. And we do meet all 12 months because we spend our summer meetings in preparing for the work that we're going to be doing during the school year. And then we just have a conclusion: a good teacher is a brilliant light, illuminating the prism of life, revealing to students a rainbow of possibilities. And it's our hope that our mentors are part of helping to light that light and make our novice teachers the very best that they can be. And I'd be happy to answer any questions that you may have.
She has a good question.
Captain Kelly.
Their salary is $25 an hour. Is
$25 an hour.
An hour throughout. And so basically this is the only number of hours they do. It's like 2 hours a week.
2 hours a week per mentee.
Can so to the HR report?
I have some mentors who have very busy lives, and they really only want to mentor one or two people. And that I accept that because they're good people and I want to keep them. But I'll have some other mentors who have much more time and would love to work with six or seven. And so we do that. But it would be six or seven mentees at 2 hours a week.
Do we have an overall budget figure for this? Ms. Landgraf, totally
well,
what the budget is in
the
mentoring.
Total budget there for this year, this proposed year. Budget is 9, 8, 14,
$111,000?
About $111,000, $112,000. I can tell you what we've spent in the last couple of years, if that's helpful to you. Last year, we spent $85,048.54. 2014, $71,501.89. 2013, $68,293.62. And in 2012, $51,509.25. It all depends on how many people we're working with. And it, in times past, before the COMAR changed, or before this was even part of COMAR, we typically mentored somebody for the first year, and then only the second year was by principal request. But now that this is a part of COMAR, right, we mentor for 2 years with a third year principal request. So that elevates the budget.
So we're required to, by COMAR, to mentor?
We are.
Every first or second year?
Correct.
Right.
Teacher. Okay.
Yeah.
So is there a requirement?
We've done this long before it became part of COMAR. We started in, as I said, 99, 2000, and it was into the 2000s. I don't have the exact year on my brain right now, but it's been several years that it's been part of COMAR.
And it really helps ease that, what we call onboarding process, is really transition that teacher and assimilate into our school system as fast as they can. I can certainly speak on my personal behalf of being a former teacher mentor, how valuable it is that we provide such a service to our first and second year teachers.
Well, I totally agree. I mean, great program. I was just happy to hear that it's required. I mean,
it is. It's mm-hmm. It is a COMAR regulation.
Yeah. Right. I believe I asked that question last year, the same thing.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah.
We're happy that it's a requirement, too, because, well, it's quite honestly, when there are money issues, budgets are tight, it's not easy, but it's understandable how something like that program could be, well, drastically reduced or eliminated. And we just think it's so important for our novice teachers to have that kind of non-evaluative, trusting person to work. And when I say non-evaluative, they don't have any formal part of an evaluation system. They do provide a lot of feedback to teachers. So they're constantly looking at what's happening and giving feedback. It just, none of that becomes part of the formal evaluation process for that novice teacher. Okay?
Thank you, Ms. Draper.
I wish you all the best for the rest of the year and a wonderful 2017.
Thank you, Ms. Draper.
Thank you.
You too.
You too.
All right. Next, we'll start dealing with the individual action items with the calendar for committee update.
It'd be Mr. Farley and Mr. Brown will be presenting, and tonight will be for an adoption of the next mid-year out calendar.
Mm-hmm. Good evening. We do have a presentation to share. Thank you, Sid. Aha. First, I just want to thank all the members of the community, parents, who are willing to collaborate on a challenging issue, which is to meet the governor's mandate and the needs of our school district. So thank you to all of them, and a special thanks to Mr. Brown and Ms. Harrison for their work. So we discussed all of those things, put out a draft, and then received public comments, which we have synthesized for you into themes, and we'll go over those themes for your benefit. We'll also present this evening the recommended calendars for the 17-18 and 18-19 school years and request the board's approval for acceptance of those calendars. Just briefly to go over these comments, we had some comments and in the interest of transparency that weren't really relevant, like I picked calendar one when there were actually two different years. So just letting you know, we didn't, We didn't couldn't do too much with those. We added, in response to the feedback, Election Day in 2018, so we took that as a day to close. We had a comment that there were too many half days in the course of the year, and we want our community members and those giving us feedback to understand that half days provide us with adequate professional development opportunities for time to, for teachers to do grading and still meet the required number of instructional days, and that's especially true in elementary schools. So we do plan to post these response themes on the website where we posted the survey. And it was tight with one day fewer these years at, with 189 to get in the professional development that we know we need so deeply. And so our compromise was the half days to get those things in. We also reduced the number of built-in snow days. People wanted more holidays. They wanted days off before Thanksgiving. They wanted more days off at the you know, springtime or at during the winter time. And so we did reduce the number of snow days by one day in order to give that time that met people's requests. And with that, I'd like to turn it over to Mr. Brown.
So the final calendar adjustments in both years, school starts the Tuesday after Labor Day and ends on June 14th. So we do meet the governor's request for the timing of the school year. The calendars do include 180 days for students and 9 professional development days for staff. If you do count professional development days on the calendar, it is more than 9, but it is 9 PD days per level. For the first time, we're actually looking at not all teachers having PD on the same days. For instance, the mid-semester break that we have at the high school, there are always 2 professional development days there. There really is no need for that type of a break now at the elementary schools because the elementary schools are on trimesters. So those days would not be elementary days off, but they are high school days off. Yes?
As long as one of our schools is open, that counts as a day?
No, actually, we have 180 days at all schools. It's just 2 days that the elementary schools are closed, the high school would be in session to make up for it. So if you actually count the total number of days that we are actually open more than 180 school days system-wide. But any one school or any one level is only open 180 days.
And that's kind of the rule then?
That's okay, what we've been told we have to do. As Mr. Farley said, we, for the first time, have looked at reducing the number of snow days from 5 days to 4 days. And when we started working on the calendar, we just didn't even think of that possibility because we've all been doing 5 days for so long. By reducing it 1 day, it gave us an extra day we could add to either prior to Thanksgiving or to that spring break time.
And just to add, if we found we had more snow days throughout the course of the year, we'd have to adjust as we always have.
One thing the group did look at was for early dismissal days, the half days, there would be no morning or afternoon pre-K. That has always been a problem with transportation. Trying to make that midday bus run to bring the morning students in for, you know, an hour and a half to 2 hours and then turn them around and send them home on a bus again. We figured it's much more cost efficient not to have pre-K that day. And that also gives additional time for the pre-K teachers to get some extra work done, and especially for the parent conferences. Since they have a larger class load anyway, they now have a little extra time for conferences. We did add the additional the Thursday before spring break in the 2017-18 calendar. That's using that extra snow day. And we added Election Day in the 2018-19 calendar. As someone pointed out in their comments, we did miss that one. And we added an additional holiday the Wednesday before Thanksgiving, that travel day in the 18-19. And we actually, in order to get both the election day and the holiday, we used that fifth snow day. And we also pushed the school year back one additional day. So it still ends on the 14th,
and
a day later than the original calendar said.
Can you reiterate the requirements of the mandate when we start, when we finish?
The governor's mandate was to start the day after Labor Day and finish by June 15th. And I think in the 18-19 school year, the 14th is a Friday.
Right.
So we made it by ending on that Friday.
It was going to end when?
Mm. It was going to end the Thursday,
Okay.
And teachers' last day would have been Friday the 14th. So that actually means that if we use all four snow days, teachers would come back that following Monday on the 17th, I believe is the date. And in calendar committees, we hate to bring either teachers or students back that next week, that Monday. But one thing we've learned in the past few years is doesn't matter how many days you plan for, the chances of us using exactly four snow days and ending on that Friday or that Monday's not likely. We're either going to extend the calendar a day or subtract days off the calendar. So really trying to end on that Friday is just not really making a lot of sense. So the PDF for the calendars, here's the calendar, the way it looks with those dates in there. This is the 17-18 calendar, and you can see we start on September 5th, and we end on the 14th for students, and the 15th will be the last day for teachers.
And this should be in your board docs document if you're having any difficulty seeing it, as I am.
Yes. And then the 18-19 is almost the identical calendar, with the exception of it has one less day at spring break time. And we do finish up on the 14th of June again, but last day for teachers would then be the 17th, because the 14th is Friday.
On both of those calendars, what is the date for the seniors graduating?
Graduation dates are not set yet.
Oh, okay.
And usually that, in fact, I'm not sure even if we have this year's graduation dates firmed up yet, do we?
June 2nd.
Oh, okay.
Easy, like a week apart.
First and second.
If the board sees fit to approve the proposed calendars, mm-hmm. I think it gives us an opportunity to put this out early to allow parents to plan ahead. For us to plan ahead, so we thank you for your consideration.
Mm-hmm. The calendar does have the marking period spelled out there as to when they would begin and end and when we would expect to see report cards and reporting to parents. This does include a day and a half for reporting to parent conferences for both the elementary and the middle in spring and fall, which was a big request that we had also, more parent conference time.
Just one more question. I understand this requirement was going to be at disadvantageous to the seniors trying to get prepared for their tests. How did this work out? I noticed you've got some half days in there that the high schools only are there. Is that how you accommodated that, or they're not going to get the days of instruction they need to do well in their tests?
Overall, they do lose a little bit of time before the
AP test.
The AP testing is the only one that's really affected by that. The PARC test is a percentage of the way through the school year, so it really doesn't matter where we begin and end. We're going to test at approximately 80% anyway. But the AP testing has a specific date, so the later in the year we start, the less instructional time there is actually before that.
And this AP testing is set up by the nation, federal? Not state.
That's set up by College Board, and
College,
they,
okay.
They determine the dates for AP testing.
And
always that first week of May, first 2 weeks of May.
One thing I just want to add to that, Captain Kelly, is many of our AP teachers, as they go through AP training, many of our students, they'll require a lot of summer assignments that they'll have to complete. Many AP teachers allow that opportunity to get a jump start on the school year as it is, just because of the level of content, the depth of the content that's required. So I know that's another way of for our AP teachers that to support them as they transition into that next academic year.
How does the late start affect our dual enrolled kids?
The
colleges are still going to start, Chesapeake's still going to start whenever they start. They're not mandated to start after Labor Day.
I'm not sure the starting date for Chesapeake. Most colleges tend to have a later start than we have in the past, and I'm not sure how the high school will handle the dual enrollment students.
I think that Chesapeake has expressed a willingness to work with schools given the change. I don't know how that's played out.
Sure. So I can add to that, which is a great question. So one of the things we've recently met with the community college, as many of the jurisdictions on the shore that students attend Chesapeake College, that this is a major topic of conversation. We're going to bring it to the high school committee, but what the community college has allowed to do is in this time that the college is open, that schools aren't, that the courses could be in some kind of hybrid where students are allowed to be able to work online, and then once the regular school year starts, they'll transition that way. So they're very open and very flexible on how to work with us so that students get off to the right start. So that's something that we've got to finalize with our high schools, but that's been part of the conversation. Good question.
Are you having that conversation with Anne Arundel also? Because a lot of the kids go to
Sure.
Anne Arundel.
Sure.
They do, especially the students that are on the island, that which is not that far. So yes, we will. It's all jurisdictions. You know, Anne Arundel County Public Schools is in a very similar boat as us. So both of our partnerships.
Any other questions? Do we make a motion or?
I move that we accept. Calendar for 2017, 2018, and 2018-2019 as presented.
Second the motion.
I have a motion that was second. Did I hear any? All in favor say aye.
Aye. Aye.
All opposed say nay. The ayes have it.
Thank you very much.
Thank you. Have a nice holiday.
Thank you, gentlemen. And I thank the entire committee, and I know Captain Kelly, you had served on a part of that committee as well, so I thank of everybody's input and hard work.
H&R report.
So we discussed earlier the new hires, retirements, separations for the most recent month. I've provided those to you in your board docs. Did you have any other questions about the HR report?
Nope. Thank you so much. I need a motion to accept the HR report as presented in closed session.
So moved.
Do I have a second?
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions, comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the HR report as presented in closed session. All in favor say yay.
Aye.
Aye. Aye.
And all opposed, the ayes have it.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Okay. Transportation is our next on our agenda.
Yes, looking for the approval of one substitute bus driver for the 2016-17 school year. Dolores Link has met all the requirements required by the Queen Anne's County Public Schools at this time. So we're looking for approval of her as a substitute school bus driver.
I make a motion that we approve Dolores Link as the substitute bus driver.
I have a second.
Second.
Okay, we have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to accept the transportation report as presented by Mr. Sid Pender. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we have the transportation bus contracts.
Yes, looking for the approval of the transportation bus contract. It's a two-year contract with the four LLCs that we currently have. So it will be for this school year and also next school year.
I make a motion to accept the transportation bus contracts for 2 years.
Second?
Second.
Okay, I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out for the policy and for the
no,
bus.
The motion to approve the
bus transportation report and substitute driver bus transportation and bus contracts.
No, wait. No, you're
combined in.
No, the transportation and the motion is to approve the 2 year transportation and bus contract.
And bus contract. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Having none, the ayes have it. Next, we're on the agenda is a field trip for the Kent Island High School lacrosse team.
No, we skipped one. We skipped the policy. Oh. 705.
Okay. I need a motion to have a third read for the cell phone policy and the military policy.
I have a question on that.
Okay.
As I've been reading that policy, for the cell phone, and maybe I'm just misunderstanding something here.
That's okay.
Because it really doesn't say where the middle school and the high school kids may use the phone other than written authorization, from a classroom teacher. I guess my question was is that I know that when the biggest complaint in September was that parents felt that the kids could use their cell phones at lunchtime and in the cafeteria and in between their classes. So I don't see this in here anywhere. Am I misreading this?
There was language that we added from feedback from our high school principals
okay.
that would allow the principal the flexibility to be able to institute the cell phone policy or use of that policy during hallway transition times or during the cafeteria at the principal's discretion.
Where is that?
Yeah, I don't see that in here anywhere.
So it's different for both schools?
It's not in here.
I'm going to that right now.
What's that, Mark?
I'm going to that right now.
Okay.
It was modified, I would say about a month ago, to add language, and I'm not sure that it got bolded. But
believe Mark, we added it in red, if you remember at the last, and we added the public comment so that if anybody had, we don't have any public comment on that. But
we sought an additional month of feedback on flexibility being offered between Queen Anne's and Kent Island High Schools for the administration to make it work for them. So,
yeah, but you have one policy at one school and you have another policy at another school.
I think it should be. No, I think they're using the same policy. He's just said in this policy, it's not here.
Well,
it's not on our new policy.
Well, I think we might be getting mixed up with procedures versus policy. We might have the same policy. Everybody's going to have the same policy
because that's
what we do. But it's how their procedures are using the policy.
And that's left up to the principal.
Right. The language that we added was to give principals that flexibility because that's currently at each of our high schools are implementing it a little bit differently. One of the things the board had asked is that to come back and look at this policy on a yearly basis. Mm-hmm. What this allows is that each school is actually implementing that at this time that way. So that brings us in line with the practice, but allows us to look at this policy each year to add that level of consistency. But we felt, and speaking with the principals, that what they wanted and felt was to allow them the flexibility and the discretion on how they wanted to implement that at their school.
Yeah, I don't agree with that.
It's not in here.
It's not.
It's not in there, and I also do not agree with that. It either has to be one policy at both schools.
Well, it's going out for a third read, so it's not the final anyway.
But that needs to be worded in there. Right. If it's going out for the third and final read, that needs to be in there.
So what I would recommend is that we'll table that to make sure that the language is clearly stated in there.
Okay.
I believe the one that was posted before was in bold, because you could see, I think it was in red, the language that we added.
And it's so I don't see it. I mean, I've read it two or three times.
If it's okay with you, we can table that. We'll make sure that it is appropriate.
Yes.
And that it's very clear to you on what it is that you're going to vote on.
That's fine. Yes.
It should be unique to the high schools, not the middle schools.
Right.
So correct.
Exactly.
And that was the only language that was in there, was just related to high schools only.
Yeah.
I'm almost
nothing
thinking that, like, when you get to C, it has middle and high school student misuse of self. I personally think that should be broke down to middle school and to high school. It should be broke down, because if you're going to let high school do differently than the middle school, then you can't put the two schools together. You can't put the same
misuse.
Yeah.
And I believe
anything that says, do you understand what I'm... Because I'm
sure to break it out is what
it
you're,
has to
what
be
you're
broke
requesting.
Down because you know, and then because if you're going to go C and you're going to go middle and high school student misuse of cell phones, smartphones, and then somewhere you know, and then you're going to add that in there,
sure.
You know, okay, well then it doesn't count for middle school, it only counts for high school,
sure.
So I think that definitely needs to be.
And I believe in the original language, it was in D.
Okay.
That I remember as we looked at that. We'll be happy to do that. So we'll bring that back.
Okay.
We'll table that, and then we'll bring that back to ensure that the language.
Okay.
I had a question, the written authorization. I haven't seen that in my schools at all. Every year,
really?
We have in here that it's supposed to come out every year. Hasn't happened in Mattapique Middle.
Centerville, it does, because I got it, and I had to fill out the whole form.
Well, it used to be in the handbook.
Yeah. Yeah, but it hasn't been collected. It hasn't been followed through. It hasn't been filed in the school to say do or don't do it, like it says in the policy here. So we need to either enforce it or take it out. And I don't really, I'm trying to question why we need to have that at all. It's just another paperwork exercise for the staffs at these schools. I mean, why does a parent have to authorize them to have a cell phone? I'm unclear as to why we have that policy.
It might make parents aware of the liability if a child loses a cell phone and they're using it in the schools. You know, I mean, that's just a guess.
But you're only talking middle school and high school because elementary cannot take a phone to school.
Right.
Were you asking why do they have them?
But why do we have it and
why
not
do we have
doing it anyhow? I mean,
so one of the things
it's
that
extra
we'll,
work for the
sure.
staff.
So one of the things that we'll do is we'll collect some more information. We'll get some feedback from
I think
our
that's
school
a good idea.
Specifically. On how that's being implemented. We'll look at if it's a consistent practice or not consistent practice and look into that a little bit further, and we'll bring that back as part of the third read. Happy to.
Okay, because I'm more
Thank
concerned
you.
Whether it's needed or not.
Sure.
So I make a motion to table the third read policy for the cell phone and for the military policy, third read, and we'll send that out forward. Can I
the
have
third them? And final read.
For the third and final read.
Can I? Both of them, right?
We're tabling the military as well?
No. We were, because we wanted to get more stuff. Right?
It was my understanding we were going to bring it back with some
yes, you're correct.
Alternate
yeah.
proposals.
So we're just going to table both.
Okay.
I need motion to be tabled then.
So with the military policy, just so I'm clear too, the board has asked us to look at some alternatives for recognition of military personnel that are employed with us in QACPS, correct?
Develop some history and to develop some ideas what other counties are doing in the state of Maryland, not just on the Eastern Shore.
On that note, Greg, 1 second. We need to make a motion.
We ain't got that far yet.
That's not there.
No, I haven't got there yet.
It's not there.
It's on the agenda.
Robin, a question on the retirement plan amendment. is that bundled in as far as, is that part of the transfers? Just ask a clarifying question. Is that, the agenda needs to be amended?
No, we need to add that to the agenda.
It needs to be amended.
Okay, I need to make a motion that we amend the agenda to add a an amendment to the retirement plan. Correct?
Wait a second. Maybe we should close out the policy first.
Okay, let's do that.
Which is, and then you can add
I thought that. We tabled both of those, so.
Well, let me just, so those are being tabled to come back to the next board.
The next board meeting.
Okay. Okay, sorry.
Okay.
So now me.
No,
the
motion.
Okay.
Sorry.
Okay. I need a motion to amend the agenda to add the amendment to the retirement plan as discussed in closed session.
So moved.
But you're making that motion?
Yeah.
I'll second it.
Okay. You have a motion and a second. Any questions or comment regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out.
No, to amend the.
To amend agenda. The two agenda for the retirement. And all in favor say aye.
Aye.
All opposed say no. The ayes have it.
Okay.
Also, I would like to make a motion to table the two, the military policies along with the cell phone policies for their third and final read. Do I have a motion?
So moved.
Second?
Second.
I have a motion to second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for a vote to table the two items, which are the telephone, cell phone policy and the military policy for their third and final read. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it.
Okay. Now I'm going to make a motion to amend the retirement. We made the motion to amend the agenda to add the amendment to the retirement plan. Now I'm going to make the motion to actually amend the retirement plan as discussed in closed session.
I'll second it.
Okay. Motion.
Okay. I have a motion. There was second. I have a motion and second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to amend the retirement plan policy as was read. All in favor say aye.
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 Opposed? The ayes have it. Okay. Next, we'll deal with the field trip for the Kent Island Lacrosse team to Isles of Palms in Charleston, South Carolina.
Sounds fun.
Did we discuss that?
Is there any information on it?
I didn't hear anybody discuss it.
I have a motion to accept the field trip to Kent Island High School.
You moved to.
I'm sorry. What did I just say?
I need a motion.
Sorry. I'm still in. Yeah. I make a motion to approve the field trip to Kent Island High School lacrosse team to the Isle of Palms, South Carolina. Charleston, South Carolina.
I second the motion.
Okay. I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion for the field trip to Kent Island High School lacrosse team to Isles of Palms and Charleston, South Carolina? I call for a vote. All in favor of the field trip say aye.
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 All opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we'll call to pay to look at the transfer of funds. Is that right?
Yeah. You have three letters in front of you requesting transfer of the funds. The first letter is to transfer money that was identified at the beginning of the year when we did our reorganization. In order to purchase an additional or to hire an additional teacher. And then the second part of that is to transfer the funds for the bus contract that we just approved. So we need, I just need a motion to be able to send that request over to the county for the transfer of those funds.
Robin, I'm sorry, because I couldn't see this in closed session. The tennis courts at Queen Anne's County High School and Kent Island High School, the $36,000, is that to resurface them?
Okay, that's not this letter.
Oh,
that's the next letter.
Oh, okay, I'm sorry, I've gone to the next letter. Okay, I'm sorry.
This is the first letter. This is where we're moving into instruction.
Okay.
And then into transportation to cover those costs.
Okay. I hit the wrong letter.
Oh, so you want me to take it from
sorry.
That's okay. There's three of them.
Okay.
So.
Okay.
Let me do the first one first.
No,
do you want to do them all at one time, or do you want to do them individually?
I would like to do them individually since it's so much,
okay.
You know, since it's my first time. Thank you very much. Appreciate it. I have a motion to transfer the funds for the hired additional teachers and for the bus contract, which was approved. Do I have a second? A motion first, I'm sorry.
So moved.
Second?
Yeah, a second.
Any questions or comment regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for a vote to send out the policies for the transfer of the funds for hired and additional teachers and also for bus contract, which was already approved. I call for the vote of the policies. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? Say no. The ayes have it.
Okay. Then we have a letter that is requesting the transfer of funds from six different capital projects that were funded by the county into one capital project in order to do the security entrances at Sellersville Elementary School and Churchill Elementary School. And all of those projects, this is the one you were asking about, the tennis courts, we did do...
We resurfaced the tennis courts.
Surfaced tennis courts a couple years ago. And
this
was,
is money left
this
over.
Okay, that's what I want
it's
to make sure.
It's already been done, yes.
Okay.
Okay.
So we're transferring... Still.
We're transferring money from six capital projects into one capital
okay.
project.
Okay.
Or requesting the county to allow
so
us to do that.
The motion is just to send that letter
over. Right. I have a motion to send the letter forward for the six capital projects for the Sellersville Elementary program. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote. All in favor, say aye.
Wait. We had a motion. We didn't have a second.
Okay.
Okay, so the original motion is to send the letter over to the county commissioners.
Right.
Regarding the six projects going into the security upgrades. Is that the
correct.
One we're on?
Okay. For Sellersville Elementary
yes.
Program.
Okay,
yes.
So that's your motion.
Mm-hmm.
Okay. I second the motion.
Okay.
Now all in favor.
No.
I have a motion. It's been second. I have a motion. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send forth the transfer for the capital project for Sellersville Elementary programs. All in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Ayes have it. Next one, Robin, is that final?
And then the last one that you have, is requesting a transfer out of our current expense fund balance over to capital in order to do, and there's six projects that are listed there, starting with sidewalk repairs, flooring repairs, and then ending with blind installation. That's $104,600 total.
I move that we send the letter to the county commissioners for the six items listed for $104,600.
I second the motion.
I have a motion and second. Any questions or comments regarding this motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send forth the letters for the six transfer balance. As listed, all in favor say aye.
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 All opposed? Ayes have it. Next, we'll deal with the student and the parents guardian grievance process.
Second read, yes.
Mm-hmm. for the second read.
Mr. Farley, I do not believe that we've received any public comment regarding second read, or maybe we have.
Thank you, Mr. Paluski. No, we have not.
You have not?
We have not received a comment on the grievance process.
I make the motion that we send the policy for the student and parent guardian grievance process out for the second read.
Do I have a second?
Second.
Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out the policy for the second read. All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it. Next, we'll have a motion for the graduation exercise recruitment, selection of staff, leadership development, and succession planning and compensation policy for a first read.
Whoa, wait a minute.
Did I skip?
Wait a minute.
Yeah. Should just be graduation
exercises.
And then comma, recruitment and selection of staff.
No.
That's been changed.
That's been changed.
Okay, so
just
cross it out.
Exercises.
Yeah, okay. Just graduation.
Okay, motions for the graduation exercise.
So, well,
go ahead.
Welcome. Thank you. We're just looking to amend this policy that was originally adopted on June 1st in 2011 to reflect some additional rationale to allow our students who are earning a certificate of completion to allow them to participate in the graduation ceremonies at the end of their 4 years beyond grade 8 mark. So a typical 12th grader, since they've spent that time with their peers throughout that time. But then also allowing them at the end of the year in which they turn 21 to re-participate in the graduation ceremonies, because for some of those students, they've spent an additional 3 or 4 years at the high school level earning that certificate of completion.
I'm confused by that. So you're telling me you want them to graduate twice?
They're not really graduating.
They're not graduating and get a certificate.
They're nearly participating in the graduation ceremonies. Mm-hmm. These are for students. These are for our students who are not earning a diploma. These are for students that are participating in the alternative academic achievement standards.
Okay, that's fine.
Mm-hmm. Do we offer any kind of job training or anything?
Actually, we do. So we have a transition specialist that works with our high school programs to connect them with the Department of Rehabilitative Services, Department of Health and Mental Hygiene as well for services beyond age 21. We also have services that we provide looking and teaching at life skills, transition services that we infuse within the classroom. We do take them out and have them go out on work-based learning as well. We have some of our students that are actually getting paid employment and others that are doing volunteer employment. I will give a shout out to Department of Social Services, who always very welcomes our students in there into their program to help with secretarial work. We have several students here that help at the board on a weekly basis as well. In addition, we have some collaboration now with Chesapeake College, where we have a course and courses that we're looking at for our transitional age youth for students age 16 and beyond, as well as a partnership with Benedictine and Department of Rehabilitative Services for these students as well.
That's good. Great. Do you have like someone to shadow them throughout their procedures from one stage to another?
For those students that need it, we do have a job coach that assists, and we look at where we can fade out those job coaches to be able to get them as independent as possible. The other for the public watching, the other ad was that under implementation, we put that because it's optional for parents at that second year to be able to notify the school principal by the start of the second semester in January. So if we need to make reasonable accommodations, such as providing access for a wheelchair, that allows us that time to be able to do that.
And Mrs. McGowan, we would be communicating with those parents
Correct.
Around.
Correct.
In the first semester, we would identify and work with those families so they're aware of the deadline.
Correct. We would be infusing it within the IEP process as we talk about the transition plan. And just when we're talking numbers, it's small numbers of students. This year, it's four students that would be participating at the end of their four-year mark, and an additional three at 21, where at Kent Island High School, we only have one student who'd be participating at the end of the four-year mark this year.
That's good.
So I make the motion that we put the policy for graduation exercises out for the first read.
A second.
I have a motion and a second. Any questions or comments regarding the motion? Hearing none, I call for the vote to send out the policy for the graduation exercises. All in favor, say aye.
Aye.
All opposed? The ayes have it.
Great. Thank you. Have a good holiday.
Thank you.
Happy holidays.
I am.
Now, did we go over to the recruitment or just eliminate all that?
The reports.
Just go to reports.
9.01.
No more motions.
Okay. Okay. Next, we'll have our interim superintendent reports by Mr. Greg Poliski.
So there's just a couple things I'd like to highlight. Number one, certainly in honor of both of our high school students being here. My wife and I had the opportunity November 4th to attend the big rivalry football game between Kent Island High School and Queen Anne's. So I was it was a great game, but very privileged to this year, Queen Anne's County High School. 21-14, I believe. 21-14. So I told them last time they wouldn't be, you know, going across the table. So, but it was a great rivalry game. It was great to be there, and a lot of team spirit on both sides. It was great. A couple other things. November 10th, I know many of the board members as well, and our student board members were there as well, that attended the conversation on race at the United Methodist Church. Was a wonderful community event.
Awesome.
And there was so much positive conversation that happened, and a lot of interest in continuing that conversation. So I wanted to recognize that. November 17th, I had two great opportunities to attend two great events. One was the first annual Chesapeake Charities Annual Award. I know many board members attended that as well. Governor Hogan was actually recognized at that, but our own Kim Umberger for our Partner for Youth program. It was a wonderful celebration of the partnership we have with our county, our local management board, and the work that they do. That evening, I also attended a community event on behalf of our partnership with the Sheriff's Office on It Can Happen to You, and that was at Queen Anne's County High School, and it was a conversation around addiction presented by the Ashley Center from Have to Grace. I know board member Harlow was there as well, and it was well attended, but I think it's this notion around addiction and certainly around the country around opiates and heroin, and how can we provide more support and outreach. And I know it was a great conversation that folks had. So last thing is we finished out our budget workshops in November. So that was great to get some community feedback. And I just want to make a plug that this is the first year we've done an online survey for those folks that couldn't attend. So we'll be sharing that with the board, those results at our upcoming work sessions related to the budget. So thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. Curriculum of instruction report by Assistant Superintendent Ms. Janet Pauls.
Okay, so you can see from the notes that our team has been very, very busy. So just generally as a summary, you can see that many of the group, including myself, have attended many stake meetings and shared the results of those meetings with the various stakeholders at different meetings, such as the assistant principals, teacher specialists, reading specialists, etc. The team has continued to provide professional development, which has been school-based and district-wide, and they have completed all observations needed for the first cycle of observations, and as they have been out and about visiting schools, as well as myself, teachers are working very, very hard, and we're proud of the great service that they provide for our students. Mm-hmm. And then you can see from the notes that the team has been very active in many community partnerships as well, so school-based and many activities during the day and after school as well. And one thing that we did this year, in lieu of providing, buying gifts for each other, we decided to buy gifts for needy students. So if you go upstairs, oh, nice. You'll see a table full of gifts for students, books, gloves, hats. And we're very excited about that initiative and can't wait to deliver that to our students and our schools.
Yes.
So kudos to the CNI team. We do have one member here with us tonight, Mr. Page. And mm-hmm. the CNI team extends a very joyous holiday and blessed holiday to you and your family.
Thank you very much. The expenditure report coming from our Chief Financial Officer, Ms. Robin Langford.
Okay, yeah, the expenditure report in front of you, it's similar to the one that you have seen in the last 2 months. And basically, there are a couple items to bring to your attention. Once again, legal fees. We're now at $20,000 over what we had originally budgeted for that. And over 50% of the fees that we have spent in legal this year have been due to our bus contract and the arbitration for our bus with our bus. Under instruction, we are a little bit over in contracted services, and that is basically associated with some contracts for professional development we had and some license agreements that we have renewed this year. Under special education, we see that there's going to be a problem under transfers. These are our non-public placement students. We have, I think, a total of six non-public placement students this year. Diane's coaching me from the back row there. A couple of those placements are over $100,000 each. So we're looking at probably being close to $95,000 over on that line item. So I'm in the process of reviewing things and trying to figure out where we're going to get those funds to cover those line items that are over. And that's essentially it. We made the transfer tonight to transfer the funds for the transportation contract, the bus contract. So that now brings that back in line. So, you have any questions?
Mm-hmm. Are these overages are 1 year things, or would we potentially be able to use our fund balance to pay for these? Or is that not legal?
In the past, we have not tried to use our fund balance to go back into the operating budget. We generally try to look within the budget itself to transfer funds to cover that. If we find ourselves in a situation at the end of the year where we don't have funds to transfer, then yes, that will be something that we might be able to do.
Yeah. But you don't have to read it. I don't think you do.
Thank you, Robin.
Say that there's nobody on the list.
Okay. Do we have any citizen participation or public comments? Any of you guys?
There's no one on the list for a second.
Okay.
Read, so.
All right. Our upcoming meetings will be on December the 21st, 2016. Will be a work session from 11 a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. January the 4th, 2017. Ooh. Board of Ed meeting for 6 o'clock p.m. January the 18th, 2017. Budget work session, 11 a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. And January 23rd, 2017, a board retreat, 9 a.m. to 3 p.m. And January 25th, 2017, I just like saying that. Budget work session, 11 a.m. to 2 o'clock p.m. All righty. I need a motion to adjourn meeting.
So moved.
Second.
All righty. I have a motion and a second. Okay, all in favor say aye.
Aye.
Opposed? Ayes have it.
Happy holidays
to
everyone.
Have a wonderful holiday.